I'd like to welcome everybody, and I'd like to welcome to this incredible event, this once-in-a-lifetime event. This is really animation's family reunion. It's a gigantic family reunion for this business. I've never seen anything like it. It's tremendous. Somebody was saying that this should be like the Olympics. People should come with flags like UPA, Warner Brothers, you know, Bluth, Disney, and walk around the room and all. It's just amazing, you know. And I mean, I've got a lot of people to thank and all to help put this together. But first and foremost is all of you. You're tremendous. It's like once we started the ball rolling and we said that, you know, Grimm's birthday was going to happen, everybody started networking and everybody started calling and talking to each other. And my phone was ringing off the hook. You know, our receptionist at Disney said, "Tom, are you running a crap game or something?" It's like, what's going on, you know? So I want to thank the Walt Disney Studios for the loan of their telephone system. And I'm giving it back now, and this is good. Just a few people I want to thank before I bring up our MC and we start the evening's addresses. I'd like to thank the Natwick family for honoring me with asking me to put this together. And it's a tremendous honor, and I feel very flattered to be counted, you know, in your community. And which were guiding angels of this operation, which was Tisa David, June Foray, and Lorraine French. And let's give them a hand. It's like, I was sort of doing little Asifa things, you know, just like sort of bring your own bottle, get some tapes, let's look at some Mickey Mouse cartoons. And then June said to me, "Well, you're going to throw Grimm's party." And I'm like, "Me? This is like something a producer should do. I'm an artist, you know, I mean, it's like, this is like a wedding reception, you know. My wife and I eloped. We didn't even have one, you know. So at one point, we'll all do the hokey pokey or something like that. Anyway, you know, I mean, June and Tisa, you know, because Tisa called me the next morning and just said, "Just get it started. People are going to come. You're going to get 400. You're going to get 500. You know, and I thought, well, yeah, you know, I mean, I've never seen an Asifa thing more than 200. Well, let me tell you, the count from the waiter is 505. And it's like every major animation studio in Los Angeles is here tonight, and most of the heads. And Yeah, there's a lot of heads here. the thing is. But anyway, the thing is, every major studio, and like folks have flown from New York, folks have flown from Vancouver, folks, yay, International Rocket Ship, yay, there we go. You know, Mike Sporn Animation from New York, and you know, all these different guys. It's just amazing. It's like once the call came out, everybody just started coming. So really, it's just a big hand goes to all of you, you know. So anyway, I'd like to also thank my collaborator and partner in crime, without whom I wouldn't have been able to do this, is Mr. Lou Studi. Where is he? Stand up. Okay. Lou's the proof of why animators need checkers. He's fantastic. Because, I mean, I'm sitting there, I'm going, "Go ahead, 100 bottles of wine, 200 bottles of wine, I don't care," you know. And Lou's going, no, look at the figures, you know, all this kind of stuff. So he's just tremendous. We fought like cats and dogs, but, you know, we really made a beautiful evening, and it's just, you know, so much is owed to him. I'd like to thank also the incredible Jerry Beck for our programs. He did a tremendous job. I might even develop an appreciation for Japanese cartoons someday, and it's wonderful. But okay, and then also I'd like to thank the incredibly fascinating Mark Kausler. Okay, who? Where is he? Stand up, Mark. Stand up. Okay. Mark not only lent his incredible film collection and stayed up all night with Phil Denslow at UCLA film chaining so we can have that little video blurb, but also he had to share a room with me while I told the same jokes to 400 different people. This is the same joke over and over and over again. And he's wonderfully patient. Okay, and also in short order, I'd like to thank all the people that helped me find addresses and get in touch with people and talk to people. And among them is Phil Denslow, Dave Smith at Disney Archives, the Motion Picture Cartoonist Local 839, who gave me like the press release, and Jeff and Lynn were tremendous help in getting addresses. UCLA, USIFA, the USIFA Board of Directors, even Alphonse's Bar helped me out once in a while. You know, it's like, it was great, you know. So anyway, without any further ado, thank you all, and I hope you're having a wonderful night. And I'm taking my phone off the hook tomorrow, so don't tell me. And it's just really, before I bring Charles up, I just want to say, if anybody ever says that animation is just a business, and it's just a bunch of people just doing things, that we're not a family, that we're not a community, that we're not like one bunch of crazy people doing something we love, well, damn, just look around you. This is incredible. So thank you. And a special thanks to Paul Mayer for bringing all the tchotchkes and everything in the back in the cocktail area. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. It looks really nice. It's really nice. And thanks a lot. It's wonderful. And Phil Denslow and Dan McLaughlin. Anyway, our moderator tonight is Charles Solomon, the animation critic at the LA Times, the man we love to hate. And he's just... so anyway. Okay, so author of Enchanted Drawings and other stuff. So I'm going to bring Charles up.
Let's see, those are the people who worked on what? DuckTales, The Jetsons, and the Saturday morning shows, I guess. We all know that Grib... Sober him up and throw him out. Okay, Grimm's work, as we know, brought the first real convincing animation of the female form to the movie screen. The people whom I'll be introducing will talk more about working with him and his career in depth and from a personal note. Tom asked me to come up with some bits of trip and of animation in some perspective. And for those of you who know Tom, that's like Arco asking someone else to drill for oil. Nonetheless, we know that Grimm was born in 1890, in the same year as Boris Pasternak and Franz Werfel. That's 25 years after Lincoln was shot, 22 years after the flip book was invented, 9 years after the gunfight at the OK Corral, and 3 years after Sherlock Holmes appeared in A Study in Scarlet. When Grimm was born, Benjamin Harrison was president of the United States, which contained 63 million people. And in that year, for the first time, the population of California topped 1 million. Victoria was queen empress of an empire on which the sun never set. Alexander III was tsar and autocrat of all the Russias. Herman Melville, Walt Whitman, Tchaikovsky, and Frederick Douglass were all still alive and working. Puccini brought out Tosca. Ibsen unveiled Hedda Gabler. Gauguin hadn't gone to Tahiti yet, and Marcel Proust was a college student who hadn't written a word. 2 years after Grimm was born, Emile Reynaud introduced his Théâtre Optique in Paris that were the first animated projections. And 5 years after that, the Lumiere brothers showed the first films. In 1899, Edward Muybridge brought out Animals in Motion, which Grimm and everyone else used as a reference ever since. 1900 saw Enchanted Drawing by J. Stuart Blackdon and the birth of Walter Lantz. Walt Disney was born the next year when Grimm was merely 11. And in 1906, the first animated film, Humorous Phases of Funny Faces, came out. Now, obviously, Grimm couldn't have wanted to be an animator when he was growing up because there was no animation to want to be. In 1913, he was already an adult, well-educated in the arts, and knew enough not to be shocked when the Armory Show introduced modern art to America. That was also the year Raoul Barré founded the first animation studio in New York City and in this country. The next year, Gertie the Dinosaur came out, and the cell was patented. In 1919, Felix and Coco made their debuts in Feline Follies and the first of the Out of the Inkwell films. And we're tactfully going to conclude the history there before we try and figure out how many years before me, Grimm was born. Our first speaker, we know and love as the creator of Pepe Le Pew, The Roadrunner and Coyote, and many of the other great Warner Brothers cartoons. The winner of 3 Oscars, a Peabody, and numerous other awards, who recently announced he's going back into production, Mr. Chuck Jones.
I drew the short straw. They went through all the people that had done the most harm to Grimm, and I picked out me as being the first one that did him the greatest harm when he first came out here.
This is the one that counts.
This one counts?
Yeah,
1, 2, 3, 4. That's the one that counts. I'll start all over again. I didn't say anything very important anyway, but I wanted to say something to Tom Seto at the outset. And in the New Yorker a number of years ago, they had a full-page cartoon of a huge statue, and it contained Hannibal crossing the Alps and 7,000 of Napoleon's troops passing in the other direction and hand wrestling in transit, and all the Greek goddesses doing naughty things to each other and so on. A huge statue, and down below were standing 2 little men. One was a sculptor, and he said it started out to be a pair of bookends. That's what I feel like tonight. You see, I'm sure Tom feels the same way. He probably started out maybe hoping for one table and ended up with this enormous thing. But I know this really, to me, as far as I'm concerned, is simply a great therapy session. By having Grimm here at 100 years old, it makes all the rest of us look like children. And when you see Walt Lantz dancing around like a 10-year-old, which indeed he was when Grimm started to vote, you begin to realize the therapeutic value of a group like this getting together. But at long last, they're scraping the top of the barrel when they get down to Natwick. I've waited 58 years to pay tribute to Grimm, one of the great draftsmen of our time. Grimm Natwick, who taught me the most valuable lesson of my life, that I couldn't draw my ass. I was Grimm's first assistant when he, Al Eukster, Bernie Wolfe, Jimmy, later Seamus Culhane, came out from New York to join up Iwerks. I don't know how many have ever spelled Iwerks backwards, but it spells screwy. I'll give you another one that you might want to mull about too if you live out in the valley, and that is try spelling Moore Park backwards sometime. It takes a little time, but it's worth it. Actually, I was an in-betweener. The elegant term assistant only came along later. As a matter of fact, Ub one time advertised in the newspaper, this was the 1930s, and he advertised for in-betweeners, and the word must have gotten around verbally, because one day he heard this guttural voice came to the telephone and said, "I understand you're looking for go-betweens," which we probably were. When there used to be a tailor on Sunset Boulevard, or Hollywood Boulevard rather, called McIntyre's, and people like Ben Clopton and Tex Avery and Frank Sinatra and so on, people who had very narrow shoulders would go there, although Tex was a little more portly than he was heavy in the shoulders. Well, they used to spread their shoulders out like this. So someone sent Natwick up there to get a suit of clothes, and they used a very heavy tweed, and they put those shoulders on him. His shoulders were already this wide, so when he came out, they were this wide, and he looked like a plaid battleship. He also had an automobile, and I don't remember the name of it, but I remember that it had a hood about 75 feet long and a tiny little conning tower on there, which Grimm could get into, but nobody else could. But when he came out here, he didn't know what he was in for. I was a parlayed cell washer. Ovid made me into an in-betweener because I was a failure as a cell washer, a painter, and an inker. Failure had gone to my head. I thought I could draw. Then Grimm Natwick came along, whereupon even my glazed and youthful eye became aware of great drawing. Grimm had gone to art school in Vienna, perhaps to avoid the draft for the Spanish-American War. And his superb drawing that he learned there made Flip the Frog into something quite beautiful and elegant, grace notes. But alas, it was no contest. For every drawing of Grimm's, there were three of mine. Once, in a generous gesture, he left 17 in-betweens and a chart showing what to do. Unfortunately, I got a hold of the wrong extreme drawing. I think it was a bulldog. And I animated the bulldog into Flip the Frog in 17 drawings. Hub then took pity on me and fired me. And in the next couple of years, I got fired quite often. I was fired twice by Walt Lantz, once when I wasn't even working for him. And then somewhat later, I went to work for Leon Schlesinger, where business manager Ray Katz didn't know the difference between a frog and a dog, or indeed between a cell washer and a director. But my short association with Grimnat was probably the most valuable of my life. He taught me by example that I couldn't draw, but more important, he instilled in me a desire to do so. I think all I wanted to do then, indeed all I want to do now, is to draw as well as Grimm Natwick. There's been a certain amount of badinage about Grimm's age, as in jokes when he was at Disney's, he was either too old or too young to be one of the nine old men. And it's certainly true that Grimm is a man who none of us knew when he was chronologically young, yet a man who all of us today know and admire and try to emulate. And what a privilege that is. My personal feeling is that Grimm Natwick, like Merlin, is going through life backwards, so that he knows everything about what is going to happen and has no intent or any interest in what has happened. But sometime when the youngest of us has gone to Forest Lawn, Grimm will be there to give us his last bon voyage. And Walt Kelly one time said that about cartooning. He said, the cartoonist becomes and stays a cartoonist because of the freedom, the peace of mind, spawned out of the fearless knowledge that he doesn't know what the hell he's doing. It's a good life, he said. I would like to say that I've heard a great many words over many years about the Magic Kingdom. But to me, speaking of the Magic Kingdom, about animation throughout the world, and most particularly throughout this area, it's about like talking about a great building without mentioning the architect. To me, if there's a Magic Kingdom, the architecture of Magic Kingdom, it's in this room tonight. The old people and the young people and the middle-aged people, like Fritz Freeling, these are the people that made this Magic Kingdom, and they're here in this room. And I just hope that no one decides to set off any kind of a detonation here, because some of the great artists and the potential artists and the young artists and the great artists of our peculiar medium are here tonight, and I'm grateful to be with you. Thank you.
As a boy, Walter Lantz told me he had gone to see Winsor McCay's vaudeville act and saw the film of Gertie the Dinosaur, and that inspired him to want to become an animator, which indeed he did, with one of the longest careers in the history of the medium. Those of us who grew up during the 50s and 60s remember Woody Woodpecker introducing him as, "Here's my boss, Walter Lantz," on the TV show we watched every week. His studio was the last of the Hollywood cartoon studios to close in 1972, long after the others had given up the ghost. And in 1979, the Motion Picture Academy honored him with an Oscar for Special Achievement. And so here's Woody's boss, Walter Lantz. You've got to get right up to it.
You know, if all these animators had to buy their own drinks, we would start this party at 7:30. You know, in 1918, I was working for the Hearst Animation Studio. Mr. Hearst decided that he would make animated cartoons using the characters in the newspapers, like the Cats and Jammer Kids and Happy Hooligan and so forth. And one day, Gregor LaCava, who was head of the studio, brought this tall, 6'2", handsome young guy. He said, "Fellas, I want you to meet my friend, Grim Natwick." Well, we all knew about Grim. He was a famous illustrator. He drew comic books and also covers for fashion magazines. And we knew that he was quite an artist. Well, anyway, Greg said, "I want you to meet this kid, Walter Lantz. He's one of our youngest animators. He'll show you the shortcuts and what not to do." So Grim joined our staff, and he became an excellent animator. I think he learned faster than anybody that ever started in the business, because he was a fine artist. Well, after about 3 or 4 years, Hearst decided that he would make more money selling papers than making animated cartoons. So he closed the studio. So I went to work for the Bray Studios, producing the Colonel Heselrod cartoons, and Grim went to Fleischer's and created that great character, Betty Boop. And you know what happened to Betty Boop? Well, the Bray Studios closed. It seemed I was always working for studios that closed. Well, anyway, when Bray Studios closed, Grim went to Fleischer's, and I was, as I said, was animating for Bray. Well, they only lasted about 4 years, and I decided to come to California. Well, can you imagine, 30 years later, Grim Natwick comes to me looking for a job. So I gave him a job as an animator animating Woody Woodpecker. And I'll tell you, he animated some of the most wonderful scenes that ever appeared in the Woody Woodpecker cartoon. Well, Grim, you're 100 years old. And I'm only 90. So God love you, Grim. When I'm 100, you'll be 110, and we'll throw the biggest party they've ever had in this town. Thank you, Grim. Grim came to work at Universal when I was 18 years old. That's when I first met Grim Natwick, and LaCava gave him a job to become an animator. Of course, he was such a good artist, I think he learned in about 2 weeks.
Just a quick announcement. You're getting an unusual little tchotchke on your desk, in front of you right now. Mr. Hicks Loki, who is one of the great animators on Disney's on Dumbo and various other films, developed a little astrological device that's used to discover the moon and stars and things like that. And he's made a whole bunch of these, and he thought it'd be really neat to share with you. So it's a little gift from Mr. Hicks Loki, and thank you. See, for $50, you get a lot of stuff here. Come on.
Certainly, Grimm's most famous creation is the redoubtable flapper Betty Boop. Although a number of actresses were experimented and tested to do her voice in the very earliest days of the character, in 1931, Mae Questel took over as Betty Coed, and she continued until the series ended in 1939. We also know her, of course, as the voice of Olive Oil, and even Popeye occasionally during the war when Jack Mercer was unavailable, and numerous other voices. In 1988, a few years later, she came back to reprise the part of Betty for Who Framed Roger Rabbit, and people who go to live-action movies as well as cartoons will remember her as the mother who announced to the world her son had wet the bed in New York Stories. That is, of course, the lovely Mae Questel.
Love good mics like this. I'm so happy I'm here tonight, really. I'm thrilled. Not only that, but I can't tell you how much I've enjoyed listening to all this. Charles Solomon with a story. We got your books. Oh, boy. This thick. I think about $90 in the store, but you can get it wholesale. Snuff. Yes, you can get it for $45 if you know people. I'm so happy to be here tonight. And a million thanks to you, Grim Natwick, for creating Betty Boop. He made the face. Just wonderful. Not only that, but the first animated American sex pot. Not only that, but she was criticized for that garter. I'll never forget it. Because I did an act as Betty Boop and some other things that I did in vaudeville. And they resented that garter that she wore. What a silly thing. Look at the actresses and what they wear today. And I can tell you, the first time that we have been out here, we met Grim Natwick. I met him at the studios, and I know one thing, he was one of the great animators for Max Fleischer. And I want you to know that my husband and I feel that everybody should always listen to Betty Boop. Because not only is she cute, but she's still alive. I loved doing this, the role of Betty Boop, and I can tell you that she actually has always been able to not only sing, but to act too, and also I was in Popeye and Olive Oil. Of course, you know who Olive Oil is, you know. You, here I am. I want to wish you all the best, Grim. You've done a wonderful thing, and you've made her alive again. And I'm so thrilled to be here tonight. My husband and I are having such a wonderful time here. And let's hope for the next 100 years you'll be around and we'll be back to give you all the credits you deserve. And a happy birthday, and I'm very happy to see here, to be here. But I can tell you this, I have a lovely friend here called June Foray, who does all those wonderful darling, I love you. And I love tonight because you were all here, and I'll tell you the truth, if I had brought some music and done a little rehearsal, I would have sung too. But all I can say, can't sing without music. All I can say is boop, boop, be doop. Thank you.
Mark Davis is one of the celebrated nine old men of Disney animation. Because even by Disney standards, he was an extraordinary draftsman, he received the somewhat thankless task of animating the heroines in the Disney films, and occasionally the villainesses. Among the characters he worked on are Snow White, Cinderella, Tinker Bell, Maleficent, and of course the flamboyant Cruella de Vil. If Cruella still has her fans, Mark. As he said, these characters which he worked on and about whom he learned from Grimm are the spine of the film, and that if you don't believe in them, you don't believe in the comedy, and the rest of the film doesn't matter. After he finished with animation, he went on to design rides for Disneyland, including the Pirates of the Caribbean and the Haunted House. And so, here is our next speaker, Mark Davis.
I met somebody recently, and they said, "You worked with Grimm Natwick?" And I said, "Yes, I was his assistant on Snow White." And they said, "What did you learn from him first?" And I said, "I learned how to drink wine." At the time I met Grimm, this was probably about 3 years after Prohibition was repealed, and what we knew about wine was that you got a half gallon for about 95 cents, and it was always red. Well, I found out from Grimm that there was wine that came white, came in smaller bottles, and was absolutely delicious. This I owe to Grimm Natwick. There's a few other things I owe to Grimm Natwick. I think all of you are aware that we're in a business that is kind of then I wrote. We don't give too much credit to other people around us, and an awful lot of people say Walt and me and so on, but knowing Grimm, when I first met him, he was so excited about the talents of other people. He would take me into the rooms of any number of the top animators, Freddie Moore, Bill Tytla, and then he would get permission and we could kind of go through all the roughs that they were throwing out, and we would look at these things and he would tell me about them. And I think this was very wonderful. Anyway, he was excited about the talents of the people that were around him and around me. And this is something that is very rare. I think we're all inclined to say, "I did this, I did that," and so on. Grimm was never that way. Grimm was excited about artists. And I envied him because, and I think a lot of us did, because he'd had the opportunity much earlier to study in Europe. And this is exciting to people like, I guess I was maybe 23 years old when I met Grimm. And well, you can figure out the bit from there. We met in 1936. Anybody who has a pencil can figure it out easily. Anyway, all I can say is this was a very wonderful man, is a very wonderful man, and happy birthday, Grimm, and many, many more.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, animation's most distinguished centenarian, Mr. Grimm Natwick.
This microphone better than I could, because I would have liked to had it about two registers higher, but I did get a lot of marks, complimentary statements, and I want to thank you, Mark, very directly. Mark and I would think our work in animation was more like a couple of brothers working together than just an animator and so-called assistant. Mark probably in many ways drew better than I did. I had the advantage of having done animation for a longer time, but I was considerably amazed through my life in the studios at men like Bill Teitler and Mark, of course, developed into a major animator at the Disney studio. But Walter Lantz and some of the Supermen, Bill Nolan, other fellows that gathered together in his studio, there were great, great talents. And any one of them, if it had been a different season, a different generation, probably would be well-known painters, well-known artists. Animation itself was a special art. To make one drawing, most of them could do that pretty well, but to keep the feeling of the character through several hundred or even several thousand drawings took a very unusual talent. And most of the animators, not only in the Disney studio, but in all of the studios, did things. I borrowed and borrowed and borrowed. Every time I would see a good scene, I'd try to get a copy of it and run it and say, how the devil did he do that? Put the drawings together and say, oh, that. I'd file it up here and use it in the next scene. And these animation, however, became so fascinating. The first
I don't want to talk to you too long. The first pictures were black and white, and they didn't have any soundtracks. We put the drawings in balloons the way they are in the newspaper, and we tried to make funny drawings, but we really did not have story men. Gregory Le Calvin, one of the first studios I worked in, pretended to write a story, but to sit down and animate it, you almost had to have a private talk with him to find out what he had in mind. And talented as he was not able to keep 10 animators busy. Walter Lantz, by the way, was an experienced animator at the time I first took a job at the Hearst International Studio. I began to learn things from Walter Lantz, and he, I guess, was the youngest man at that time on the payroll. But I had one desire. I met a few of the artists who were doing covers for Saturday Evening Post, people like Dean Cornwell and a few others, and they were getting $2,500 for a single drawing. Here we were making 500 drawings to earn that much. So I kept going back to school, and that is probably the main reason that I eventually began animating girls. I spent 8 years in art schools, 3 in Chicago and a couple in New York. When I'd saved little money, I went over to Europe, and I discovered, there is an interesting story behind this, but it'd take too long. Simmering it down after World War I, when we were all released from the army, I had had a pretty good job. I was doing song covers for a song printer, and there were hundreds of amateur songwriters in America, so he could keep me pretty busy doing some. But after the war, the government, the United States government, dismissed us and gave us each $60. So I took mine and bought a suit of clothes that never fit, but we got so used to army uniforms, we lost our vision. When we stood in front of the mirror, we saw something that wasn't really there. So I phoned my friend Le Calva, who by that time had been put in charge of an animation group that I first mentioned roughly. The drawings were printed black and white and no colors, so you could never build anything around a color pattern. But we thought we learned how to gag a little bit. One gag, and now it seems extremely stupid to me, but it came out of this brain, and it was the best I could do at that time. Judge Rumhauser and Silk Hat Harry were two close friends. The judge was a court judge, presumably, and Silk Hat Harry was a gambling idiot who was crazy about pretty nightclub girls. So he was always leading the judge away, and the judge's wife was about this tall, and this broad was continually looking for her husband in the impure nightclub dance halls. So she appeared before one of them in a big-chested, husky uniform. Man was out there outside. He put up his hand. He said, "You can't go in there, lady," and in a balloon, of course. And she just stared at him, and two arrows came out of her eyes and pierced him right in the head. And he just rippled down until there was nothing but a black spot on the floor. She stepped over that and went in and got the judge, who was there, of course. And he was dancing with the pretty blonde, and up to the time that his wife was able to get hold of his collar. So that was my first animation, and the first gag that I thought, really, that came out of this little brain right here. And I became... Am I talking too much? Anyway, it finally color came in. And the sound was in the film. You didn't have the silly balloons up there to read. The Mutt and Jeffs, I remember always, I think Jeff was the short one, and Mutt was the tall one. Jeff would insult him, and the last frame of the film, a brick would be hitting Jeff in the back of the head and picked him up off the floor. Scared him out of the scene. So the gags did not come from the minds of genius. But the audience didn't mind any more than we did. So it turned out to be a very easy way to make a job. But I recall vividly, of course, I should say that I always had one great passion that was to develop my artistic talent to where I could make one of those $2,500 covers for Saturday Night Post. And I thought the way to learn to do that is to go to art school. So I spent 3 years at the Chicago Art Institute, and on weekends I learned to design designs for song covers. In those days, with the limited musical recording, almost every family had an organ, and one person knew how, or a piano, one person knew how to play it. And the rest of the family stood around and sang, and they entertained themselves. Of course, that's all been changed with the development of sound and color in film. But I was leaving somewhere, but I got lost on a cow pass somewhere on the way.
Grandma, you want to say some thank yous, and we'll present you with your cake.
Oh, well, I'm beginning to think that I'm a better talker than I was an animator in those days.
We don't want you to wear yourself out.
I am going to stop talking. But I did, finally. I finished a fine art education at the Academy of Fine Arts in Vienna, Austria, and one thing that I did learn, which most, unfortunately, most of the animators did not. A lot of them could draw a pretty girl, but they couldn't animate. I had learned animation, and I finally learned to draw a cute girl, one of them being Betty Boop, which, of course, is...
We don't want you to wear yourself out here.
No, they don't want me to wear myself out, so I'm going to stop talking.
Okay, and now to conclude the festivities.
I love this, man. I love him.
Antron Manoogian, the president of Asifa Hollywood, will present Grimm with his birthday cake.
Oh, it's this one. Okay, fiddling with the wrong mic. Actually, I'm not going to present the birthday cake. We'll be doing that after. But instead, I have a special presentation that I'm going to be making to Grimm. But before I begin, I'd like to first off thank everyone again who made this evening's event possible. Of course, there were many individuals whose individual efforts made this party a reality, but of course, I don't have all the time in the world to thank each and every one of them. I would, however, like to acknowledge two individuals who were primarily responsible for coordinating Grimm Natwick's birthday party, and they are Tom Cito and Lou Studi. And of course, I'd like to thank all of you for attending this function. It was an astounding turnout, quite more than we could even imagine, as Tom was saying earlier. And of course, I want to thank you for coming. Your participation has made this event a huge success. Furthermore, I'd like to take this opportunity for those of you who aren't members of Asifa Hollywood, I'd like to invite you to join our organization. Your support will allow us to continue putting on events such as this, as well as sponsor other activities that will help promote the art of animation. Earlier this year, when the board of directors decided that we wanted to undertake this project of giving Grimm Natwick his 100th birthday party, it was decided that we wanted to give the proceeds from the sale of the tickets to this party to Grimm as a birthday present. So at this time, I'd like to present Grimm a check in the amount of $5,328. And 16 cents. Grimm, congratulations and happy birthday.
Grim, this is Leonard Maltin, and I was heartbroken not to be able to be among the people celebrating your birthday a few weeks ago. I was out of town and couldn't manage to be there, but at least I can be here on this tape to wish you a happy birthday and tell you how much your work has meant to me for so many, many years. Congratulations.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Grim.
Grim Natwick, you know, was in many studios, in Fleischer's and Disney's and Lance and UPA. And, you know, he taught Mark Davis how to animate, and he taught Chuck Jones how to animate. You know, and so he had this great universal appeal, you know. And also he's really older than animation. He's actually, this one man's lifespan was older than the medium, because he was born in 1890. And animation was born between 1900 and 1906. And, you know, he was 11 when Walt Disney was born. You know, I mean, this is special, you know. And I think everybody realized that, you know. And so once we sort of got the ball rolling, the networking took over. You know, people calling each other and people, you know, passing the word. And I'd be getting phone calls from guys I didn't even know were alive, you know. I'm just like, oh, I want to come to Grimm's party. I knew him when I was a little kid, and he was an old man, and now I'm an old man, and he's an older man, and it's amazing, you know.